Carlos Ramirez, owner of NVS Audio in Roselle, New Jersey. So I made the video about the high power 10-inch mid-bass drivers that are available on the motorcycle market today. Everybody wanted a clear answer to which one is better. Better is subjective. There is no better. There is different applications where some would work better than others. But as far as better, the four speakers are completely different. The reason I waited so long to make the video is originally I only had two speakers to compare. That was the DC-10 versus Euphoria xpert Carbon 10. Couldn't compare the two because I couldn't find a bag that the DC fit in. And they were available at different price points too. So now with Keith Barker's 10-inch mid-bass driver and the new high-power Cicada 10-inch mid-bass driver, now we actually had a nice variety to pick from. So after running my test, they all handle an insane amount of power. They all sound really good. I've tested every single one on a 5,000, on a 3,000, and on a 1600.1. So we're talking 800 watts RMS apiece, all the way up to over 2,000 watts RMS apiece. And they all did really well. And I did not blow a woofer during the test. One thing that I could tell you is the Euphoria xpert Carbon's kind of finicky. It wants a good clean tune. It does not take abuse from distortion, but it also works in the smallest amount of airspace. The Euphoria Carbon actually doesn't like a big bag. It likes less than a cubic foot. It likes less than 1.5 cubic feet. I've confirmed this with Scott Owens. We found that the sweet spot for it is right around 1 cube, sealed and ported, but it works really well in stock bags, unsealed, and it works really well in aftermarket bags. It's a very versatile woofer. Another thing that I realize is all these woofers require some sort of modification if you're using a standard 10-inch ring. If you're using Nagy's Monster 10-inch rings, then they all fit. Some require the gasket surround to be removed. Some require the edge to be milled down. But I don't know which one you're going to choose, because I'm an authorized dealer for all four, and I have all four in stock. So it's different tools in your arsenal to be used for different jobs and different applications. So I don't think this video is gonna cause less confusion. I think it's gonna cause more confusion, because it's gonna make the choice even harder. I've played all four woofers. All four woofers sound really good. All four woofers handle an insane amount of power. So it's gonna come down to your builder, your tuner, most importantly, the airspace in the bag. Most importantly, the tune. Second most important is the airspace you have available in the bag, how well you reinforce the bag, and how well you brace the bag, because these woofers get violent on big power. I've seen every single one of these woofers win a competition. So it's not a one-size-fits-all. Maybe it's going to come down to what you have access to, who your authorized dealer is, what brand your builder feels comfortable with. They do have different sounds. They all have a different sound. They all get low. I tested them with test tones and the bass mechanic CD because I want it to be a nice, even, level playing feel. They all sound different playing music. So I recommend you go down to your local shop that has them installed and take a listen to them. So here at the shop, we have we always have bikes with the Cicada 10s in it. One of our shop bikes has the DC woofers loaded in it. And another one of the shop bikes has the Euphoria xpert Carbon. So it's a completely different sound, all different power ratings. Is your entire install in the fairing, or all your amps in the fairing? Then maybe you should pick one that's more efficient, because you can only run a 1600, unless you've done one of the newer Lex racks and cut everything in the fairing to make it fit. Because I've seen people stuff 5Ks and 3Ks in the fairing. In that case, you can run whatever you want. But here's the numbers. These are the tests. It's a pretty long video, but hope this helps. Carlos Ramirez, owner of NVS Audio in Roselle, New Jersey. So I've been trying to make this video for a while. People have been asking for this video for a while. It's the comparison of the biggest, most powerful 10-inch mid-bass drivers that are currently out for motorcycle audio. So now, originally when I wanted to make this video, it was the Euphoria xpert Carbon versus the DC 10-inch Pro mid-bass. The reason I held off on making the video was I felt it was comparing apples to oranges, and there was no real fair comparison I could make between the two, other than they're both 10-inch mid-bass drivers.
The Euphoria Xpert is a Neo. The DC Audio is a ferrite magnet, so the Euphoria Xpert's a lot slimmer, even though they both handle a ton of power. The biggest issue I had was I could not find a bag that I could fit the DC Audio woofer in. It does not fit in any Harley Davidson bag stock, and it doesn't fit in 90% of the aftermarket Harley Davidson bags. I was working with Cody at Voodoo. He was supposed to send me a set of prototype bags, but it never worked out. But I did end up figuring out a bag that I could fit them in, and that's what I tested them in. Comparing a driver that doesn't fit in anything to a driver that fits in everything, including stock bags, I don't think was fair, so I didn't do that. So I waited for a few more players to arrive in the arena, and that's when the Cicada 10-inch mid-bass drivers came in, and Keith Barker's 10-inch mid-bass driver came into play. So these three woofers fit in stock bags and most aftermarket bags. The DC does not. So it made the test make more sense, and it gave clients a lot more options, and it made it easier for me because it takes me a really long time to make and edit these videos. So to compare four products is more worthwhile to me than just comparing two very unsimilar products. So every woofer on this table handles a obscene amount of power. There's been a lot of controversy around the Keith Barker's mid-bass driver. We are not getting involved in that. We are going to let the runners of the competition, so we're going to let Ricky Wills from Team Money Cycles, we're going to let the guys from Sound Wars, we're going to let them decide if this woofer is allowed in competition or not. I'm just going to tell you how much power we ran to it, how it sounds, how it performs. I'm not even going to run pink noise through it. I'm going to leave that to you guys. I'm just going to compare the performance. So let's say that these are all allowed in competition. I'm just going to compare how they did, and you guys decide what you want to use. Now, everybody wants a clear, simple answer on which one is the best. The problem with best is that is subjective. That means that's left to interpretation or opinion. I'm all about science and numbers and facts, and I personally don't care which one you use because I'm an authorized dealer for all of them, and I have all of them in stock. So whatever you feel is best for you, you can use. I'm just here to tell you what I tested, what works, and what doesn't work. So first, we're going to start off with something that makes me upset. So when I started in the industry back in the early 90s, we didn't have the ability to research stuff on the internet. We didn't have Google. You guys have so much access to information, but most people won't even do a little bit of studying. They just want a clear and simple answer without doing any sort of research. So Scott released a chart on what the recommended enclosures are. And of course, he is a Euphoria Xpert dealer, so he made the chart for the Euphoria Xpert carbon fiber mid-bass. This chart applies to every single woofer on the market. People don't realize when you port an enclosure, you're not making it work with the woofer. You're designing the enclosure and the port to work with the enclosure. So what people don't realize, and I talk to people all the time that call me for help, and I ask them, so I don't know how you build the enclosure and then look for a speaker to work in the enclosure. You're supposed to pick the speaker, find out what the speaker wants or doesn't want, then build the enclosure around the speaker. So many times I get a phone call and they tell me I have this bag and I have this much airspace and it's got this port, and then they got to try and make a woofer work. That's backwards. Decide what woofer fits in your enclosure, then look at what the woofer requirements are, then build the enclosure around the woofer. It's really, really strange to me that they do that. Like, we run every enclosure that we build here, we run through Term Lab, and Pee-wee and I just built an enclosure last week where we modeled it in the software 11 or 12 times before we made the decision and cut a single piece of wood. So to build the enclosure first, then hope that the woofer works in the enclosure is ass backwards, and it's very expensive. It's a lot of trial and error, considering these woofers average about $600 each. So Scott made a chart, and it makes it pretty simple. So if you look at the chart, and it just amazes me that Scott had to make this chart, because all you have to do is Google subwoofer enclosure port calculator, and it's going to tell you all the same stuff that Scott's chart tells you. But Scott made it very easy. People are using PVC pipe to make port, and there's nothing wrong with that. The issue is, if you're not a fabricator like we are, it's very difficult to attach the port to the bag, not have the port fall out, to drill out the hole in the bag exactly perfect so the pipe fits. So there's a ton of fabricators that could do it really easily and really well. And I have a ton of tools. It's really easy for me to do. But most do-it-yourselfers don't. So Scott designed a port that has a flange and it's adjustable. So all you need is a hole saw and three screws to mount it. So it makes it super easy. His ports are 3 inches. The ports that we use here are also 3 inches. And with Scott's design, if you pay attention to the chart, he will show you how to make his woofer sound great in the enclosure, depending on how much airspace you have. Looking at the chart, Scott knows. Scott's been into big bass professional audio since the 90s. Scott's been winning first place trophies building loud SPL cars when I was just starting out in this industry. Scott is a rock star, knows what the hell he's doing, super professional, super smart, and he's really hard to beat in the ring because he's got so many years of experience, and it's all about math. So a lot of times I'll get a phone call, and I'll ask the client what the bag is tuned to, and they'll say something insane like 34 hertz or 35 hertz or 40 hertz on a stock bag. Listen, if you look at the chart, or if you run any port calculator, it is physically impossible to have a stock bag, which normally ends up around 0.7 after woofer displacement, port displacement, to play into the 30s or 40s. So if you look at Scott's chart, if you have a bag that's 0.7 or 0.8, it cannot play to 38 hertz, no matter what size port you use. If you're at 0.7, you can't get 38, you can't get 40. But if you have a 14.2 inch, 3-inch tube, you can get to 42 hertz. That's a long-ass tube. So a tube basically takes a... He didn't go any longer than that because obviously it won't fit in the bag even after you make it right angle. Because you got to remember, the bag has the woofer in the center, so it only gives you a certain amount of space to go outside of the woofer or under the woofer. So if you have a stock bag, and by stock bag I mean CVO bag, ST bags, regular standard bags, you have less than a cubic foot of airspace. I don't care what anybody tells you. And in stock bags, you're not playing below 42 hertz. Most of these bags end up playing between 50 and 55 hertz. So if you have 0.7 airspace, which most of these bags end up with, and you do a port that's 8, 9, 10 inches long, trust me, you're in the 50s. But if you want to calculate your airspace, there's a very simple way to do it. Grab a box. See if you can find one that's 12 inches by 12 inches, 12 inches. So you want it to be 12 inches high, 12 inch width, 12 inches deep. So the reason you want to do that is this is 1 cubic foot. It's 12 by 12 by 12. If you take that and you divide it by 1728, so 12 times 12 times 12 divided by 1728, that's how many inches are in a square foot, in a cubic foot. You will get 1. So 12 times 12 times 12 divided by 1728 equals 1. So this is 1 cubic foot of volume. Then you want to cut the top off, and you want to make yourself a 12 by 12, or maybe a little bit smaller, 11.5 by 11.5 square. So now, we use styrofoam peanuts. You can tell there's styrofoam peanuts in there. So if you can fill your saddlebag with the woofer in it and the port in it, but you have to tape the opening of the port off, that way the peanuts don't go in the port. What people don't realize is the air that's in the port does not belong to the enclosure, it belongs to the port. So that has to be subtracted, that's your port displacement. The air that the woofer itself takes up belongs to the woofer. does not belong to the enclosure because that's the woofer displacement. So I recommend putting tape around the woofer. That way the peanuts don't go into the woofer openings. Put tape around the inside of the port, then fill your bag with styrofoam peanuts. If you can fill the bag 2 times with a box of styrofoam peanuts, that's 2 cubic feet. If you can fill it 1.5 times, that's 1.5 cubic feet. Right now we have 0.25, 1/4 cubic foot of styrofoam peanuts in the enclosure. What I did was I drew lines. So each one of these lines is 3 inches. So 3, 6, 9, 12 inches. So the top of this line would be 1/4 cubic foot. So now if you look in the enclosure, we are at the bottom line. See the line drawn there? So there is 0.25 cubic feet of styrofoam peanuts in this enclosure. So if we filled one full box into the bag and then it took to the line, one line, that is 1.25 cubic feet. Very simple to figure out. It's pretty damn accurate. You will be accurate to within 1/8 cubic foot, which is more than accurate enough to figure this out. So go out, measure your bags. If you thought your bags were over a cubic foot and you have stock bags, you're gonna be very disappointed. So that's a quick, easy way to figure out how much airspace you have to work with. Then you go and download Scott's chart and you can figure out your port length. So simple and easy, it's not complicated. There's port calculators online or you can go off Scott's chart. Most popular ports to use in motorcycle audio is 3 or 4 inch ports. And then you could use the port calculator and figure it out. It's simple math. I don't know why people don't understand this. We just built an enclosure that's tuned to 32 hertz. The enclosure ended up being over 2 cubic feet. And after port displacement and everything, we netted out like 1.25. And this is all done. We did it all through Term Lab. So do a little bit of math. That way you're not surprised with the results when your bike doesn't sound good. So, okay. So we've gone over ports. We've gone over airspace calculations. So the reason it was not easy to compare these woofers to each other is they're completely different. So these 3 woofers fit in a stock bag. This one doesn't. They all have different power handlings. They all have different price points. So the Euphoria xpert is the most expensive. So Euphoria xpert 10 MB Carbon XL, they're $900 each retail. I couldn't find official pricing on Keith Barker's 10-inch mid-bass driver. I heard through the grapevine that they are around $200 each, which makes it the least expensive out of all the woofers in the category. The Cicada CMB10.S4, so it's a Cicada mid-bass, 10-inch, single forum coil. They're $600 each. They actually came down in price. They were around $700, $750 when they were released. And the DC Audio, it's a DC Pro Audio 10 MB, 10-inch mid-bass, and they're $600 each. So now we have 3 different price points. We have different fitments, and we have different power handling. The other thing is these woofers do not fit in a standard mounting ring. So we use Nagy rings here at the shop. If you get the Euphoria xpert Carbon or the DC Audio, I'm telling you right now, it's not gonna drop into the ring. So what you have to do is you have to either grind it, make a jig for it, cut it on the, it's very sketchy. You can cut your fingers off. Be very careful. DC Audio has already cut the flange down for you. So when you buy the woofer, if you remove the gasket, you'll notice that the woofer's already been cut down. So it's awesome that they do that because most people don't have the tools that we have to be able to modify the woofer. So if you see right there, the screw hole, you can already tell it's cut because it's silver, not black. And the mounting hole is very near the edge. So that's what the Euphoria woofer looks like after we modify it. These are Tim Nagy's monster rings. You have to reach out and ask him because these rings he made when the Euphoria came out and the DC Audio came out because it did not fit in his standard rings. So he came out with the Monster rings. The Monster rings, you can tell because the edge is a lot thinner right here, because the woofer now comes so close to the top of the bag that he had to thin this section out so it would clear, and then it's also tapered. These woofers now drop in if you're using this Monster ring. See that? It's not going to fit in this standard ring. Let me show you. So we keep making Tim's life a nightmare by coming out with all these new speakers. So he originally modified the ring. So now we have one ring from 98 through 13 and 14 to 23. So he was able to adapt the ring so it fits all the years now. So it's only one ring. Then he came out with the Monster ring for these woofers. And then he modified his standard ring to make it try and fit everything. That way there's only just one part number. Let's grab Euphoria instead. So as you can see, the woofer does not fit because the hole is a little too small. So you would have to open up. So he modified the top part of the ring so the flange fits that part. These are his new standard rings, not his Monster rings. So if you bought rings from him in the past 2 months, it works. So now it's easy. You just have to open up this part of the hole and the woofer will drop in. He's already addressed the issue that the flange didn't fit. So now you don't have to cut the flange anymore. So that is his standard ring. I don't know if he's still offering the Monster rings, but if you order the Monster rings, it drops right in, no problem. These are only needed if you're running the Euphoria Carbon XLs or the DC Audio mid-bass. Keith Barker's woofer fits in the standard ring, and the Cicada woofer fits in the standard ring. So if you're running stock bags, you have no choice. You can't use the DC woofer. You can use Cicada, you can use the Keith Barker woofer, or you could use the Euphoria Xpert Carbon, as long as you're running a Monster ring or you modify his standard ring. If you have bags that already have 10-inch cutouts in them, you will have to cut the flange. You will have to machine the flange. And after you're done machining the flange, it will look like the way the DC woofer comes. Even the DC woofer, I had to sand it a little bit more to get it to fit in the last set of bags that I did. They were voodoo bags. This is what the ring will look like after you modify it. See that? So if your bag has a 10-inch ring built into it already, believe me, the woofer is not going to be a drop-in fit unless you're using one of these smaller woofers. So now that we've gotten that out of the way, we have mounting rings, we have modified flange. I have blown every single woofer on the table. So when I get a woofer in for testing, I know my clients are destructive. I know a lot of the clients out there are destructive. I mean, we're Harley guys. So what I do is I like to see what the mechanical limit of the speaker is. And I want to make sure these manufacturers are being truthful. So it took a lot of power to blow these woofers. Out of all of them, the Euphoria Xpert was the most sensitive, and Keith Barker's woofer. It's not fair to judge them on that because they are physically smaller than the other two. The Euphoria Xpert, since the day it was released, we've had an issue with abusive customers. They do not like dirty signal. Well, no speaker likes a dirty signal, but these are more sensitive to it. you have to have a really good tune. Your airspace has to be really dialed in. You have to use a clean amplifier. If these woofers do not like any sort of clipping whatsoever. So if you don't have a good tuner, you don't know what you're doing, do not run extreme power on these woofers. Now, it's not the woofer's fault. It's definitely the builder's fault, and I can prove it. During my initial testing, I blew the woofer up on 3,000 watts. We currently have a few bikes out there running the same exact woofer on 5,000 watts. So, clean power with a good tune. These things will take 2,500 watts apiece all day. All these woofers will. But that leads me to another point. People don't understand. First of all, it's physically impossible for a 10-inch woofer of this class to handle 2,500 watts. If you understand physics, first of all, you're not going to be able to get your bike to generate 5,000 watts of power unless you're running multiple batteries. That's number one. Number two, these woofers have what's called box rise when you put them in a really small enclosure. So what happens is the impedance of the woofer rises up so high that if you have 2,500 watts running to the woofer might see 200-300 watts at certain frequencies. That's why people are like, oh, I have an 8K, oh, I have a 5K, oh, I have 3,000. Speaker's not seeing anywhere near that power. So, for example, carbon fiber XL. So we ran 60 volts at AC, which equates to right around 1,200 watts. And that was at 120 hertz. Woofer handled it beautifully, no problem. So now if you take the same 60 volts AC, which we agree is around 1,200 watts, because it's a 3-ohm woofer, and then to do that, all you have to do is, so when you hear people setting their gains with an AC meter, what they're doing is they're taking a test frequency, running the test frequency through the speaker, so the test tone, and then using a regular AC meter. Once the wave reaches clipping, they back down a little bit, and then that AC reading, they take it, it's Ohm's law. So they take it, they multiply it times itself. So in this case, it was 120 hertz test tone. So 60 volts times 60 volts divided by 3 with 3-ohm woofer equates to right around 1,200 watts RMS. So now I use my impedance meter by SMD, my IMSG, and I did a sweep on the woofer. Free air sitting on the table at, let's see, at 60 hertz, we had a resonant frequency, I'm sorry, we had an impedance of 20 ohms. So 20 ohms out of a 3-ohm woofer, when you do the calculations, it's still the same 60 volts squared, so 60 times 60 divided by 20 is only 180 watts. So in theory, that's why you have to be super careful when tuning, because let's say we'll keep the same 1200 watts to make the math simple. So if you're running 1200 watts to this woofer, as soon as you get to 60 hertz, the woofer is going to have almost no output because the impedance went up so high. So then inversely, you have to be careful, because let's say you get 1,200 watts of this woofer at 60 hertz. Then when you go to 120 hertz, you're going to end up with 4 or 5 times the amount of power, and you're going to blow the woofer. So that's where understanding what the woofer does at certain frequencies comes into play, and it's very, very important and very tricky. That's also why I like to have a narrow bandwidth when I tune my woofers. That way, the output is predictable, and the power range is predictable. So let's say you have the woofer playing from 20 hertz to 500 hertz. That's a lot of impedance swings, and the voltage can change drastically, and it's hard to control. But let's say you narrow that down to 45 to 150. Now it's very predictable about what it's going to do in between those frequencies. Okay, another thing is, we build a lot of rider bikes, we build a few competition bikes, we build park lot pimps, and I'm constantly getting phone calls from my clients how they went to a competition and lost or came in third place. First of all, We built your rider bike. If you wanted a competition bike, it's a completely, totally different deal. People don't understand. If you build a competition bike, it's high power, low speaker count. If you're building a parking lot pimp, then it's high speaker count, low power. It's all about the reliability and not wiping out speakers. So if you pull up to a show and you decide to compete and you have stock bags or extended bags or CVO bags, and the person next to you has a set of Voodoo Wraith bags, with the same equipment and a similar tune, you will get run over. It's simple math. If you have bigger bags and they're built right and they're tuned right, they will play lower than smaller bags. So if you want to compete, make sure you have the right bags, because your highs will be on point. The mids will sound beautiful. When that bass drops, you're going to get run over. So we have a lot of clients that start as parking lot pimps and then upgrade the competition. And the first thing I do is have them order big bags. So if you notice most of the guys competing run the same bags or similar bags, it's because there's no replacement for displacement. If you're running 1.5 cubic feet, 2 cubic feet, you can get these things to play down really low. You can get down into the 30s. If you're running stock bags and you're 0.7 or even 1 cubic foot, it's only so low you can go. The other issue is really deep woofers like this will not fit in stock bags. Currently, I think the Voodoo bags are one of the only bags that the DC woofer fits in. They also fit in Victory bags. It requires a small spacer, but you can get these into Victory bags. I know because I've done it. So, gone over a few things. The amount of power that they handle. How to measure airspace. Okay, so I tested each one of these woofers individually, and we'll start with the DC woofer. The DC woofer, I recommend running on a 5,000 or an 8,000. So that would be technically 2,500 watts to 4,000 watts per woofer. Now, like I said earlier in the video, on these bikes, you're really not going to see that much power, because most of these bikes don't have the available battery capacitance. Like, just because you did 1 or 2 batteries doesn't mean you can run it in 8K. So good rule of thumb is 3 to 4,000 watts RMS per each lithium battery. So if you're running an 8K, that bike's going to need 3 batteries. But whatever, you do what you want. I'm just explaining to you the laws of physics. So after box rise and the impedance rise, because when you take a woofer and put it in an enclosure that's too small, and all these saddlebags are too small, you're going to get what's an impedance rise. So what that means is the woofer, if you measure these woofers here while they're sitting, they're going to measure 2 ohms, 4 ohms, 3 ohms. Once you put in the enclosure, that's going to go up. And while it's playing, it's going to go up even higher. The smaller the enclosure, the higher the impedance. It's just simple laws of physics. So we're using these giant amplifiers to overcome the fact that the impedance went up so high on the woofer. So I measured each of these woofers. So at 44 hertz, the DC woofer is averaging 17 ohms. At 44 hertz, the Cicada woofer is averaging 33 ohms. So let's back up to make sure I said that right. So the DC woofer at 44 hertz is averaging 17 ohms. The Cicada woofer at 44 hertz is averaging 33 ohms. Keith Barker's woofer at 45 hertz is around 11 ohms per coil. So if you series them, you'd be around 22. And if you run them in parallel, you get it. So on and so forth. The Euphoria xpert woofer at 60 ohms, at 60 hertz, it was 20 ohms. So that's really high impedance. Think about that. 60 hertz, 20 ohms. So that means that at 60 hertz, this woofer can basically handle any amount of power. But the math changes once the frequency goes higher or lower. So at the same power level, at the same AC voltage from the amp, the woofer can see up to 8 times more power than at different frequencies. So you have to be careful with that, and this is all stuff you have to calculate. The port affects the woofer impedance, the size of the enclosure affects woofer impedance, and that changes the amount of power that can be applied. So just because your woofer can technically handle 2,000-3,000 watts at a certain frequency doesn't mean it's going to handle that at other frequencies. Be very careful. So if you look at Scott's chart, there's no woofer that can play down below 40 hertz in less than a cubic foot. So take that into account as you're designing your setup and building your setup. So all these woofers need at least the 3K to tickle them to do anything because of the impedance rise of the enclosure. So don't try and run them on 800. Don't try and run them on a 1200. You can get away, 1200 maybe. You can get away with running them on a 1600 or 3K. But this woofer, the DC woofer, I definitely recommend a 5K or an 8K. You can run it on less power, but does it really make sense? And then the other issue I have with this woofer, it's a great woofer, it sounds incredible, handles an amazing amount of power. But let's say you're building a Harley and you want to use these woofers, and you have to order the Wraith kit from Voodoo to make it fit, to make it drop in. Now you're at $7,000 for a rear end kit, plus paint, fitment, alignment. So if you've invested, let's say after paint and fitment, you're into the kit, $12,000, $13,000, $14,000. Do you really want to compete in featherweight or lightweight class after you invested all that money? You will dominate the class if you're running any of these woofers in such a rear end kit. But most competitors that are going to build and spend that kind of money are probably going to compete in welterweight or higher, where you have more choice of woofers, because these are currently the three baddest, in my opinion, high power mid bass drivers that you can get. If you switch over to subwoofers, then you have a lot more choices, and most of them are built like this. So I think I've covered all the bases. Let's take a couple video clips of the woofers playing so you can see what each woofer does, and then just pick which woofer is right for you. So we have the DC audio. We've run this one on a 5K and an 8K. I really don't recommend running on less than 5K because you don't really get the output. The woofer doesn't really start moving until you're at that power level. The Cicada mid-bass driver, this thing works really, really well on anything from 1600 watts to 5000 watts. 5000 is extreme, that's on the top end. We run them all the time on 1600.1 and 3000.1. We have a few bikes out there that have them on a 5000.1. They can take the abuse, they play low. The other problem with these woofers is they're low efficiency, so they require a ton of power to even them, make them move. So if you look at the Euphoria Carbon versus the regular Euphoria 10, you can run the regular Euphoria 10 on much less power because it's a lot higher efficiency. So what efficiency means is it takes less power to make the speaker play loud. But inversely proportional, if you have a speaker with low efficiency, it can take way more power and hit way harder, but it's going to take more power to do it. So if you don't have power available and you're trying to keep, then these are not the woofers for you. These woofers are super power hungry. They want 3K or better. They want a 3,000 watt or better. You can get away with 1600 or 1200, but if you're going to spend $1,000 or $600 or $600, then obviously you want to make some noise and you need the amplifier power to be able to do it. That said, unless you can go to a shop that does extreme fabrication, these are going to require an amp mounted in the tour pack. 90% of the installs that we do are amplifiers in the fairing, so the biggest that we can do without cutting and chopping stuff up is a 1600.1. So 1600.1 will not work for the DC woofer. It will work for the other three, but it's definitely on the low end of the scale of the power that I would recommend to run these woofers to get the most out of them. So let's get to the video of all the woofers playing. You decide what's right to you for you. So we have the Euphoria xpert Carbon XL, $900 each. The Keith Barker, the controversial mid-bass driver that everybody's talking about now. I'm not sure yet because it's not posted on the site. I think they're $200 each, so this makes it the most affordable out of all four. We have the Cicada CMB10S4. Super heavy woofer. It's a really good all-around woofer. Handles a ton of power. You can run it on a 1200, 1600, 3000, or a 5000. Works in stock bags, fits in stock bags, works really well in big bags too. And then we have the monster, the biggest of the bunch, the DC Audio Pro 10MB, $600 each, same price as Cicada. Does not fit in stock bags, will work in victory bags, but you better fiberglass, you better reinforce, and works excellent in the Voodoo Wraith bags. Produced a insane amount of bass. So let's go to the video, hear these woofers playing.
So when you're using the SMD meter, this is the IMSG. It's the impedance signal generator, and it's very crucial when you want to see what the exact tune frequency of your saddlebag or your subwoofer enclosure is. Whenever we get a bike in for a wiring rescue or a tune, we ask the client what the bags are tuned to. They either don't know or the number that they were told is completely off. So most of these bags, after fiberglass work and port and woofer displacement, if the bag started at 1.5 or 1.2 cubic feet, it's probably going to end up closer to 0.75 after you're all said and done. The problem is they're going online or they're measuring the bag without displacement, or measuring the bag from the outside and saying, oh, okay, I got 1.2, 1.4 cubic feet, so it should be tuned to 38 hertz. That's not what's happening because they're not accounting for displacement. So I'm going to show you now that we took one of the bags. I did the styrofoam trick to measure the airspace. I ended up with about 0.75 of airspace. And then after it was all said and done, I used the impedance meter to generate tones. The meter will give you two peaks. So it's going to give you an impedance peak where the resistance is going to go really high on the low side. Then it's going to give you another one on the high side. So it's very simple. I'm going to do it live for you so you can see it. So you start at the lowest frequency and you turn the knob slowly. See, we're at 8 hertz and you turn the knob slowly. As you turn the knob, right here where it says Z open, that's the resistance of the woofer while it's playing. Obviously, it's open because we don't have anything connected to it. But as you go up, it's going to start really low, 2 ohms, 4 ohms. Then it's going to go up 8, 10, 12 ohms. Then it's going to go back down 2 ohms, 4 ohms. Then it's going to go back up again. So the center in between those two frequencies is your tuned frequency for your saddlebag or your subwoofer enclosure, whatever you're measuring. So I already knew, because I'd measured the bag and I know the length of the port, so I already knew what the bag was tuned to, but I just wanted to verify, and I was accurate to within 2 hertz, and the airspace I was accurate to within 1/4 of a cubic foot. So that's pretty damn accurate. The problem is, the reason this is so important, when you're tuning these bikes, if you don't know what the tuning frequency is, the rule of thumb is basically a half of an octave below the tuning frequency of the port. So if you think that the tuning frequency of the port is 30 hertz, then you're gonna tune it in the 20s and you're gonna blow the woofer if the port's actually 40. So if it's 40, you're supposed to go half, and octave is easy. So a full octave would, from 40 would be 20. Octave sounds confusing, but it's simple. If you're 1,000 hertz, one octave below would be 500 hertz. One octave above would be 2,000 hertz. So if you're at 40, an octave below would be 30. A half octave would be between 40 and 30, so it would be 35. So if you're at 40, then it would be 30 for a full octave, so then it would be 35 in between. If you think you're at 30, but you're at 40, you're going to end up a full 10 hertz below where you should be, and that's where bad things happen. If you're doing, this information is useful if you're doing a 6.5 or an 8 in fairing. You want to tune the lowest you want to play that speaker is around 1 octave below the FS. So if you have an FS of 80, you don't want to tune it below 40. If you have an FS of 200, you don't want to tune it below 100. And that's just, now these rules of thumbs also depend on how much power you're running. The higher power you're running, the higher you're going to have to tune it. so you don't overdrive the woofer. Now this works for, so the half and double octave tuning works for tweeters, mid-range, mid-bass speakers. Once you're running anything inside of a saddlebag, that becomes different because the FS changes once you load the speaker into the enclosure, and that's why you need one of these. So you can see what the new frequency is, because now the speaker and the enclosure have a relationship which changes that number. So I've checked all these speakers. I know what the FS is of all these speakers, free air, and I also know what the FS is loading the enclosure, and I also know the tuning frequency of the three different enclosures I'm going to show you now. Okay, I wrote down an example to make the math a little bit easier. So let's say your port tuning frequency is 33 hertz. One octave down from 33 would be 16.5. A half octave of the 16.5 would be 8.25 hertz. So you take 33 hertz, subtract 8.25 hertz, and that comes out to 24.7 hertz. So that would be your subsonic filter or your bandpass filter on the low side, high passing the woofer, so it does not play below that frequency. I hope it's not too complicated. I hope you understand it. This will help you from keep from blowing up speakers. This is very important. This is something we use every single day. A lot of people out there think that their saddlebags are a lot larger than they are. So with the few small tips I gave you today, you can go out and measure your bags and know exactly, and then you can go over your tuning and see why it is that you're having problems. I guarantee you it's gonna be one of these things. So if you start out with a 2 cubic foot enclosure, by the time you're done with reinforcing, bracing, woofer displacement, port displacement, wouldn't be surprised to see it at about 1.5, 1.7. And when you start out with a stock saddlebag, you're gonna end up less than half a cubic foot, even if you have extended bags, but I'm gonna show you here now. Okay, we're testing the Cicada woofer. Now the free air resin frequency is woofer's 44. Now you're gonna notice that since it's an enclosure, it will no longer be 44. So we're gonna look for the two peaks now. So the woofer's 4 ohms, and there we're at 4 ohms at 8 hertz. So we're gonna bring it up until the impedance goes up. The first time, there it is going up. And at 36 hertz, we peaked out at 21 ohms. There's our first spike. Now the impedance is going to go back down as we go up. And we passed it. There's our second spike. So it was 36 and 83. So when we do the math, this port is tuned to 60 hertz. 60 hertz, one octave below would be 30. Half an octave up from there would give us a tuning frequency of 45 hertz. Well, the tuning frequency of the port is 60 hertz. Our high pass or subsonic on the bandpass filter would be 45 to protect the woofer from blowing up. So you would tune this from 45 up to wherever you want it to cut off the top end. 150, 250, 350, for it's up to you and your preference. But to protect it on the low S side, no lower than 45 hertz. This port is right around 3x6. So if we go over to the chart, 0.7, 6-inch port, right around 58, 60 hertz. So my math agrees with Scott's chart. So 58, 60, 6 inches. That's what this woofer will be tuned to in this enclosure. The math just works. And we would set a high pass filter of 45 hertz to protect the woofer from blowing up. If we put this woofer in a larger enclosure, then if you notice, as the enclosure gets larger, the bass gets deep, it gets lower. So with the same tube and a 1 cubic foot bag, we're in the 40s.
It's really, really big, but there's a couple of things that I like. First of all, when you open the box, this thing was literally just made a few months ago. Freshness dating right on the package. They've already cut the flange down because they knew it's not going to fit in the standard hole with this oversized flange. So once you remove the gasket, you'll notice the flange has already been machined. The reason that's a big deal is I normally have to do this on the router table or on the bandsaw, and it's kind of sketchy and a little bit dangerous, and I hate doing it. So the fact that they've already done it is friggin' great, and it makes my life easy. So now this thing's gonna drop right in to that bag.
This the one.
Hardcore dance that has gotten to be a little bit out of control. It's cool.